have no borders. When I was a stranger knocking at your door, you took me in with no questions and no conditions. When I was a sinner running from your grace, you called me friend. You called me friend. There are no outsiders to your love. We are all welcome, there's grace enough. When I have wandered, Lord, your cross is the open door. There are no outsiders. I'm not. The harbor in every tempest. When my soul is shipwrecked, toss upon the waves, you calm the storm. You are the Father.
Welcome. Welcome to worship, everyone. It is good that you are here and that we are here together, recognizing, celebrating and knowing God, the God of love and grace. Thank you to everyone sharing in our worship today, and thank you to Sarah who is offering a message for us. Wherever you are, at home or on holiday perhaps, you are all welcome. Come with purpose into the presence of the living God. Come to worship and to be amazed to discover and learn new things. Come, knowing that God welcomes us all with open arms. Amen.
Prayers of praise. Living Lord, we praise you that you are a God who loves. You have given us an amazing world to live in and to share with all your people. You, O God, love everyone just the same, and we thank you that we are each unique. Thank you that each one of us has so much to give and to receive from each other. Thank you for every new experience that you give to us. Lord God, as we come before you now, we open our hearts to you. Help us to see that we can learn so much from others, even from those with whom we think we may not share much in common. Make us willing to stand out from the crowd, to hear your voice and act upon it. Lord, be merciful and bless us. May your face smile with favour on us. Amen.
A prayer of confession. Lord, sometimes we look as though we are listening to others. We may even make all the right noises, but we confess that our attention is often anywhere but where it is supposed to be. Forgive us, Lord, for missed opportunities. Sometimes we are too distracted by our own concerns. We care only for ourselves and listen to those who say what we want to hear. Forgive us, Lord, for missed opportunities. Sometimes we don't listen to people because we don't like them or because they are different from us. Sometimes we have bad or unhelpful thoughts. Forgive us, Lord, for missed opportunities. Sometimes we don't listen to you, Lord, because we are too busy or a bit frightened about what you might say to us. Forgive us, Lord, for missed opportunities. Amen.
We now sing together the song. It may be familiar to you. Maybe new to you, but let's have a look and a listen and sing together. Look around you. Can you see?
Look around you. Can you see? Times of trouble. See the violence Feel the heart burns, all my people weep with me.
The reading is taken from Matthew chapter 15, verses 10 to 28. Then he called the crowd to him and said to them, "Listen and understand. It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but it is what comes out of the mouth that defiles." Then the disciples approached and said to him, "Do you know that the Pharisees took offence when they heard what you said?" He answered, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Let them alone, they are blind guides of the blind, and if one blind person guides another, both will fall in a pit." But Peter said to him, "Explain this parable to us." Then he said, "Are you still without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth enters the stomach and goes out into the sewer? But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this is what defiles. For out of the heart comes evil intentions, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, and slander. These are what defile a person, but to eat with unwashed hands does not defile." Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all, and his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yes, even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. Thanks be to God.
A very well-known song that reminds us of the love of Jesus, the love of Jesus for us, and our commitment to love one another. We sing together this song, "A New Commandment."
When the last time was that you felt invisible? When you said something, but what you said wasn't heard? When you went somewhere, but nobody spoke to you, and you left feeling that you might just as well not have gone? When you had a particular skill that could have been used and would have been helpful, but you were overlooked? For some, this, sadly, is a regular occurrence in our churches. And the reasons can be many. It might be age, race, gender, disability, wealth, preconceptions, misconceptions, false assumptions. The list could go on. But in all cases, these reasons often unwittingly can and do exclude people. This is, however, not a new experience. The New Testament itself does not know of a perfect Christian community. Throughout the ages, the church has excluded many, believing it was acting fairly and justly by adhering to its well-established boundaries. And in this current age, the church is being challenged to acknowledge the ways in which it has failed and fails to live up to its calling. In our gospel reading today, Jesus himself is seen to be challenging the Pharisees and scribes over their misunderstandings about what determines who is acceptable before God or not, based on the purity laws found in Leviticus. It all starts with the Pharisees criticizing Jesus' followers over their hygiene, to which Jesus replies that what makes people good does not come from what they put in their mouths, but what comes out. Because it is what comes out that reveals what motivates a person deep down. People demonstrate whether they are good or not, he says, not by the rules that they follow, but by what they say and how they treat other people. As we know, words are often an indication of what is really going on inside people's thoughts and hearts, particularly when they are not concentrating very hard. What motivates us, Jesus warns, is given away in the thoughts and the words which come bubbling up from the depths of our personality, regardless of our outer actions. What follows next in our reading is somewhat intriguing, therefore. Does Jesus himself get caught off guard by the Canaanite woman when his concentration levels are low? Why would he seemingly ignore and refuse to help someone in need just because they were different? Why would he appear to shake off the disciples' request for him to send her away by saying, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel"? And surely the writer does not intend to give us a bad impression of Jesus when he finally turns to the woman and likens her to a dog. Has Jesus for a moment let his guard down and forgotten his own teaching that it is not what goes in, but what comes out that matters? Personally, I think this is unlikely. In the same way that Jesus was challenged by his mother at the wedding in Cana to turn water into wine, and Jesus' retort to his mother was, "My hour has not yet come," I think, along with other theologians, that we find ourselves once again at a point where Jesus' fundamental mission is being defined. Was his message aimed purely for God's people, Israel, or the wider world? If the people of Israel were to spread the good news that Jesus was the long-awaited Messiah to the wider world, then there was indeed much need for the people of Israel to hear and be reminded of God's promises. But as so often happens, the future intention for the good news about Jesus to be spread far and wide was breaking into the present, and it catches Jesus by surprise. Some suggest that in Jesus' retort to the woman, "It's not fair to take the children's food and feed it to the dogs," that Jesus is testing her, and that such a sharp debate between Jesus and the Canaanite people was part of their religious culture. Others hope to reduce the impact of what was a contemptuous insult even in those days by arguing that the word Jesus uses here for dogs, cunaria, would not have been used to describe scavenging street dogs, but little household pets, and would have been used affectionately and compassionately by Jesus. We cannot escape the fact, however, that the woman is likened to a dog, which even in today's context is a derogatory term. What great strength of character and quick wit this woman uses, therefore, to respond to Jesus. "Yes," she says, "the dogs can't share the children's food, but they can pick up the scraps." In these words, she challenges Jesus to listen, as she insists on her point. Whilst God's message at this point might be for the people of Israel, ultimately they would be called to spread it to the wider world, bringing God's blessing to all. We can take heart that in a society in which women didn't speak to men, this woman didn't give up, didn't take offence, wouldn't take no for an answer, and was heard. In her response, Jesus sees not only her great faith in him as the Messiah, but also her understanding about the way in which the good news that God's love is for all people will be spread. And he responds by meeting her needs. Her daughter is healed instantly. she is offered salvation. She is fed, and indeed she is included in the heavenly banquet that is for all. Even as we say in our services of Holy Communion, we are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table. So she becomes one of us, and we are one with her, and all are equal. From early on in the Christian movement, the acceptance of Gentiles on equal terms with the people of Israel was fought for, not least by Paul, whose message, as can be read in Acts 16, verses 11 to 40, was open to and inclusive of all, without distinction of gender, social status, or ethnicity. This year, Methodist Conference voted to bolster the work on equality, division, and inclusion throughout the connection, calling on all Methodists to engage in their churches and contexts to confront and challenge all racism and other forms of unjust discrimination. It also voted to incorporate work already started to include people who are intersex or transgender into the life of the church, into the inclusive church strategy. Within Methodism, all are welcome in the broadest sense. The emphasis is on God's grace for all without any exceptions. And hospitality, openness, and welcome remain at the heart of what it means to be a Methodist, as the Church strives to be an inclusive community in which all feel they belong. An inclusive community in which all accept each other, encourage each other, and bear with one another in love, as an expression of the new commandment which Jesus gave: love one another as I have loved you. As we seek to be more inclusive within our churches, we, like Jesus and Paul before us, need to look at who is missing from our communities within our churches and seek to understand why. We need to listen to those, like the Canaanite woman, who feel excluded, and be prepared to be challenged by what they have to say to us. We need to ensure that all people feel valued, heard, involved, and included, and we must be alert to any inadvertent exclusion or prejudice through our own ignorance. This is no easy challenge, but this gospel story demonstrates that the unconditional love and grace of God in Jesus has come, not just for his own people, and certainly not just for people like us, but for all. Together, may we prayerfully discern and continue to reflect on how we, as individuals and as a church, embody and seek to live out that unconditional love for all in every part of our own and the church's life. Amen.
Thank you.
Lord, the Canaanite woman sought your help. She loved her daughter so much, she was so desperately in need, that she couldn't give up till she had her answer. We pray in faith. Lord, may we learn from this woman to wait on you expectantly, patiently, persistently, relentlessly. Grant us the courage of our convictions when we truly believe we are doing your will. We pray in faith. We pray today for those who feel excluded, whatever their situation, whatever the reason, for prisoners, refugees, the homeless, for the sick, the mentally unstable, for any who feel that they are outsiders. We pray in faith. We pray for those in our churches and in our communities, those that we know and love. We pray for those who are sick, those who are sad, those who are lonely. We pray for those who are in any kind of distress or concern. We pray especially for the families of Dillis Smith and Dorothy Collison as we remember their lives and giving thanks that they are now at peace. We pray in faith. And finally, Lord, we pray for ourselves, especially when our faith is weak, or when we feel that we just don't belong. We pray in faith. Amen. Perhaps one of the more well-known hymns of more recent years that reminds us of the kind of life that we are called to lead and the church to which we are called to be a part. We sing together this hymn, "Let Us Build a House." We go out today, renewed and strengthened in faith, ready to serve you, Lord, and to find you in the people we meet. We go out to follow you and our hearts. Lead us, good Lord. Amen.